wish that you could see it all made new. You saw creation groaning. Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? Does the Father truly love us? Does the Spirit move among us? And is Jesus our Messiah? Hold forever those he loves. Does our God intend to dwell again where he lies?
Yeah.
is he worthy of this? Sing together.
You know, well, first, good morning, church. Good morning. Wow, we got kind of lopsided this week. Oh, it's because of those Olivers. They moved. Very cool. You know, after we sing songs of praise, I think probably everybody's noticed we clap. You know, we're not applauding for the singers when we do that. y'all are good though. That's called a clap offering. And we're showing our appreciation for the Lord and all that He has done. So remember that after we sing. When you're clapping, guys, none of this. It's more like, all right, cool. Quick reminder, corporate prayer this afternoon here at the church at 3 o'clock. Hope that many of you can make it. And really looking forward to that. Prayer's been a big thing this week, as it should be every week. Lord's message for us today, among other things, Matthew, chapter 22, starting in verse 1. This is out of the Message. Jesus responded by telling still more stories. God's kingdom, he said, is like a king who threw a wedding banquet for his son. He sent out servants to call in all the invited guests, and they wouldn't come. He sent out another round of servants, instructing them to tell guests, "Look, everything is on a table. The prime rib is ready for carving. Come to the feast." They only shrugged their shoulders and went off. One to weed his garden, another to work in his shop. The rest, with nothing better to do, beat up the messengers and then killed them. The king was outraged and sent his soldiers to destroy those thugs and level their city. Then he told his servants, "We have a wedding banquet all prepared, but no guests. The ones I invited weren't up to it. Go out to the busiest intersections in town and invite anyone you find to the banquet." The servants went out on the streets and rounded up everyone they laid eyes on, good and bad, regardless. And so the banquet was on, every place filled. When the king entered and looked over the scene, he spotted a man who wasn't properly dressed. He said to him, "Friend, how dare you come in here looking like that?" The man was speechless. Then the king told his servants, "Get him out of here, fast. Tie him up and ship him to hell, and make sure he doesn't get back in." That's what I mean when I say many get invited, only a few make it. Interesting. You know, the events of the last 10 months have stirred up a lot of people. We're seeing it all over the place. The other day I heard an interesting statistic. The number one downloaded podcast this year, anywhere on the internet, has been The Bible, read by James Earl Jones. Many are getting stirred up. When, after Jesus had met with the woman at the well and declared himself for the first time publicly that he was indeed the Messiah, and she ran off to tell everybody about it, he said to his disciples, "Do you not say," when they asked him about it, "did you tell her?" "Yeah," he said, "I told her." He said, "Do you not say that there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for harvest." You know, it's always been our job to take part in that harvest. This past week, I heard another very interesting statistic, and I know that many of you here have already heard this same thing, because my source is the same thing that many of us has been watching this past week. Here we are, 1,800 years, well, before that, 1,800 years after the time of Christ, the largest religion on earth by population was Islam. 1,800 years after Christ, the largest portion of the world by population were Muslim. Well, you know, that got a lot of people going. We started sending out evangelists, evangelizing, missions all over the world, professional preachers all over the world, trying to convert people to Christianity, and did a fairly good job. Fast forward to today, Christianity is indeed the largest religion in the world by population. 32% of of the world's population is Christian, 21% is Muslim, 14% is Hindu, and 6% is Buddhist. Just before ascending into heaven, Jesus told his disciples, this was after he was resurrected, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." He didn't say, go out and convert everybody to Christianity. What he did say was, make disciples. Discipleship is teaching everyone everything you know about him and his ways. If you think back to that scripture I just read, teaching them to observe all the things that I have commanded you. So it's not about evangelizing and bringing people to Christ. It's about going out and teaching everything that we know about Christ to everybody. The duty belongs to us. It's a duty that he gave us. The results are up to God. Over time, because somehow Christianity became this thing of evangelizing, we truly haven't gotten very far. What it's really about is each and every one of us reaching out and teaching everything we know to somebody else. Each one, reach one. Each one, teach one. Think about it for a minute. If every single Christian on the face of the earth, over the course of the coming year, got hooked up with one person and discipled them, 1 year later, 64% of the world would be Christian. And if all of those people did the same thing in the second year, at the end of 2 years, 100% of the population on earth would be Christian. We tend to think of reaching out as often being somebody else's job. It's not. It's our job. And maybe if we've been thinking that it's the pastor's job, it's the preacher's job, it's Billy Graham's job to go out and speak to large crowds and bring people over, we're really abdicating our authority, the authority that Jesus has given us to go out and do this, to disciple. So I leave you with a challenge today, each and every one of you. This year, each one, reach one. Each one, teach one. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you have given us all of your authority and that we have what it takes by calling on your authority and bringing it down here into history. Lord, we have the ability to go out and do that great commission that you gave us to make disciples of all nations. Lord, we thank you for bringing that to our mind, to our remembrance, and telling us what it's all about. And like that scripture said, like you said, you will be with us to the end of the age. You'll be with us. You'll help us. You'll show us what to teach. Each one. Lord, we lift you up. We thank you for this glorious day that you've made. We thank you, Lord, that you've given us this place where we can gather and lift up our praises and our worship to you. We're here to do that. We know your Spirit is here, Lord. We ask that you just invade our hearts and that as we praise you, Lord, that you'll hear our voice. And it'll be a sweet, sweet sound to your ear. And Lord, we thank you for our pastor. We thank you, Lord, that you've given him a message for us today, a word for us today, your word. We ask, Lord, that you open up our ears and our eyes and our hearts and minds. Lord, that we would be able to receive the message that you have for each and every one of us today. And all of us together. Lord, all the glory and all of this belongs to you. We say it today. We thank you. In the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. Go say hi to somebody. Mm-hmm.
the song of the forgiven, drowning out the endless long rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, the song born of a grateful choir.
You can't tell them to be good. They're going to children's church. Ah, sugar. Jack Handy, in his book Fuzzy Memories, tells the story of a bully who demanded his lunch money every day when he was a child in school. Handy was smaller than the bully, so he simply gave the bully his money. "Then I decided to fight back," Handy says. "I started taking karate lessons, but the instructor wanted $5 a lesson. That was a lot of money, he says. I found that it was cheaper to pay the bully, so I gave up karate. You know, unfortunately, a lot of Christians feel that way today. When they fight Satan, they think it's easier to pay the bully than it is to learn how to fight him. What we don't realize is that we're much part of a much larger scheme going on, that there's a battle in heaven between angels and demons on a grand scale. And behind the scene, there's a war going on, of which we're just a small part. However, because of that encounter, we have supernatural abilities that we need to use on how we can beat the devil. So today, how should we do it? How do we do it? We're going to read Romans. We could read Romans. We're going to read Revelation chapter 12. And we're going to find out that we can overcome the bully who wants to discourage us and tell us that, no, we will never win, that it's just the way it is, that we have to stay this way. So Revelation chapter 12, beginning in verse 1. And a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. She was pregnant. She was crying out in birth pains as the agony of giving birth. This is the first of four scenes in the cosmic combat, and the first scene is a woman in labor. This woman is none other than the nation of Israel. In several places in the Old Testament, she's described as being a woman in labor in Isaiah 66, in Micah 4. And then the sun and the moon and the stars is an allusion to Joseph's dream that he had in Genesis 37, where he told his family that one day that all of you will bow down to me. And so here's the description of Israel's family, all bowing down. And the 12 became the 12 tribes of Israel. So you can't miss that allusion here in chapter 12. It's clearly a reference to the nation of Israel. So the first scene is a woman in labor. The second scene is a dragon waiting. Revelation 12, verse 3. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his head 7 diadems. His tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven and cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she bore her child, he might devour it. Uplifting sermon is so far, isn't it? The red dragon is none other than Satan himself. And the reason I say that is because it's important for us to understand and to know who our enemy is. We have to understand that he is out to destroy us, to seek and kill and destroy us. He's not our friend. The world is not our friend. We have abilities that we can use, that we can stop Satan's threats and thwarts against us. Thwarts? Can't believe I used that in a sentence. Thank you. But he's Satan, and he's waiting for to devour the long-awaited Messiah of Israel. At one time, this red dragon was none other than Lucifer. He was God's highest archangel. He rebelled against God and recruited a third of the angels to join him. That's what it means when it says in verse 4 that his tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven. Did we miss verse 3, didn't we? Did we do verse 3? Okay, all right, I'm sorry. I lost myself. Thanks for paying attention. Okay. This side is good today. Usually they're the ones that are falling asleep, but today, that's good. Thank you. So after that, God pronounced his doom on Satan, and he said that the seed will kill you. And so he found out that he could fatally wound that serpent. So we saw when Jesus was born, Herod was satanically moved to kill all the male children in Bethlehem over 2 years and younger, because he was afraid that one of them might be the Messiah. He was so messed up in his mind that he even killed his own son, thinking that somehow somebody got to his son that he might be the Messiah. But in a dream, God warned Joseph to take the family to go to Egypt so the henchmen could not get him. But Satan hounded him. He hounded him all his whole life. The Pharisees always tried to trap him. People tried to push him over a cliff. Satan thought that he had him when he nailed him to a cross. Revelation 5 says, 12 verse 5 says, she gave birth to a male child, one who is to rule all the nations with a rod of iron, but her child was caught up to God and to his throne. That child rose from the dead and is now seated in the place of all authority with God's throne. This is none other than Jesus, who will rule the nations with a rod of iron. This is Jesus. This is the child. So did Satan succeed in killing? Nah, not even. If anything, it made God mad that he even tried to do this. But Satan was all anxious and excited about, oh, I finally did it. I finally killed the seed of the woman. So the first scene in this cosmic fight is a woman in labor. The second scene is a dragon waiting. The third scene here is the sun ruling. The child's in charge. Jesus reigns over Satan himself and will protect his own. As we go through the book of Revelation, we need to remember that Jesus is going to take care of his own people, that he will protect us, that he will watch out for us, that he will lead us where he wants us to go, and that he gives us the tools to, like I said, to defeat the enemy. Verse 6, and the woman fled, and the woman fled into the wilderness where she has a place prepared by God in which she is to be nourished for 1260 days, or the last 3.5 years of the tribulation. There's no other reason to take this other than literal. It's 1260 days, 3.5 years. At the midpoint of the tribulation, Israel will be forced to retreat from her homeland and be forced into the wilderness or into the desert. It's probably likely that she will be taken to Petra, which is a walled city. If you've ever seen stories or heard stories of Petra, it's a great fortified city. It's a rocked wall. There's only one way in. Everything's built into this cliff. And there it says God will protect her for 1260 days until Jesus comes back and sets up his kingdom on earth. Now this will be the worst of times in earth's history, but even then Jesus is in charge and will care for his people. And that's the point of these first three points. That's what we must believe if we're going to overcome that bully, the evil one in our everyday life. If you want to conquer spiritual forces in your life, you must believe that Jesus has already won the war. We're going to lose some battles here and there, but Jesus has won the war. Pick your battles carefully, right? Don't start fighting every little thing. Don't think that there's a demon behind every bush. Don't start picking on people, because people are not our enemies. We have to remember that. Just like Jack said this morning, our job is to evangelize them, to disciple them. How can we not pray for them? Okay. You have to know in your heart of hearts that Christ has already conquered Satan on the cross. Be absolutely convinced that your Lord has already overcome the evil one. You have to know that. You have to know that he wins and that the devil loses. Oftentimes our perspective gets skewed. We start looking at the things that are going on in our life and the trials that we face, and we've lost that heavenly perspective. We need to change our perspective and look at it from God's point of view. God knows everything from the beginning to the end. He knows that when Satan is about to do something to you, that you look at it through his lenses. And then we'll get there in a second. But it's not really a formula, but there's a series of things that we can do to make Satan flee from us. And the key thing is that we have to do is we have to say it out loud. Satan cannot read your mind. That's why when you pray, you should pray out loud, because Satan can hear you then, and you claim the blood of Jesus Christ on your house and your family and your job and everything else. Satan can't stand that. That's why when we're singing praises here, devil's not here. The Spirit of God is here. The Spirit of God is filling this place. So the first scene is a woman in labor. The second scene is a dragon waiting. The third scene is the sun ruling. And hallelujah, the fourth scene is Satan falling. Look at verse 7. Now war arose in heaven, Michael and his angels fighting against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back, but he was defeated. I'd like that. You like that? Okay. He was defeated, and there was no longer any place for them in heaven, and the great dragon was thrown down. That ancient serpent who is called the devil, or the slanderer, and Satan, the adversary, the deceiver of the whole world, he was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Hallelujah. Man, that's good. So this is what's going on behind the scene. Michael and his angels are fighting demons in the heavenly places. And this actually hasn't happened yet, because the context tells us this takes place during the tribulation, the 1260 days, or 3.5 years before Jesus comes back and sets up his kingdom. Satan is already defeated, but he hasn't fallen from heaven yet. He still has access to God and his throne. You can see that in Job 1, where he goes to God and says, you know, have you ever considered your servant Job? The only reason he likes you is because you've been giving him things. If you take everything away from him, he'll curse you to his face. And God said, do it, but don't kill him. Zechariah 3, Satan is with the angel of the Lord accusing Joshua, the high priest of Israel. And in Luke 22, Satan has asked permission for God to sift Peter like wheat. Satan is trying to get us. Satan is in heaven today slandering God's people. The old devil, the slanderer, the accuser of our brothers, is up in heaven now. And he says, look, there's Pastor Tom down there. His church loves him, but they think that he's a good man, but really he's not. He's vile. He's a cheater. He's lying. He desires the praises of people more than your approval. He's a dirty, rotten sinner. Lord, why do you put up with him? You know what I say? It starts with Satan is accusing us every day. And so if you have thoughts of self-accusation or thoughts of accusing a brother or sister, they don't come from God. They come from the devil. Okay? Verse 10 calls him the accuser of our brothers. But thankfully, we have an advocate. In 1 John 2, 1, it says, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Oh, man. If anything you're thankful for, be thankful that God is on your side and that he's taking charge of you and he's taking care of you. He's looking out for you. There's a day coming when the devil won't slander us anymore. Oh, hallelujah. Won't that be a great day? Verse 10. And I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ has come, for the accuser of our brothers has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God. The devil, our accuser, will be thrown down. Satan, our adversary, is already defeated, and he will fall. Believe it, dear friends, that if you want victory in this life today, believe that Jesus has already won the war, and then boldly declare your allegiance to him. Boldly declare your allegiance to him. Stand up. It's time that the Christian church stands up for what is right. The world and its system is telling us everything is wrong. Well, what they say it's right, but we know that is wrong. they say it's really no big deal to kill, you know, millions and millions of babies because they're really not they're not children. It's time to stand up and say, yes, they are children, and we need to stop this. I think it was Ruth Graham who says, if God doesn't judge America, then he needs to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. Wow. Courageously testify that you stand with Christ who shed blood and won the victory for you and all God's people. Confidently bear witness that Jesus is your victorious Lord and Savior through his death on the cross. It's the only way that we are going to win is by the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. Verse 11, and they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives even unto death. What a strange, what a great verse that we love Jesus that much that we don't care if we die or not. If someone comes up to us and says, it's time to meet your maker, let's go. Let's go. Right? We overcome Satan by depending on the blood of Christ and by declaring our allegiance to Christ, even if it means death. The blood of Christ shed on the cross disarms Satan, according to Colossians 2:15. The cross rendered Satan powerless, according to Hebrews 2:14. And when we testify that we belong to Christ, when we declare our allegiance to him, we remind Satan that we are on the winning side and that he is going to lose. You know, so many times in our lives we act like we're defeated because of things that come along in our lives, and we feel down and we feel dejected and we feel just left out. We need to remember that we're victorious. Satan hasn't won anything. He may come against you, but we come against him in the name of Jesus Christ and covered by his blood. There's a story that Erwin Lutzer, if you've never listened to Erwin Lutzer before, he's the pastor of Moody Church in Chicago. And he talks about a time when he watched a program on the Animal Channel that showed a herd of buffalo and six lions. The lions were plotting to have buffalo for dinner, so they found one buffalo that had strayed from the rest, maybe a couple hundred yards away, and they went after that buffalo. One lion grabbed the heel of the back leg of the buffalo and the other back leg, and they just hung on until the buffalo slowed to a stop. Then one lion hopped on his back, another went after his stomach, and from there on you can just visualize how it happened. It was gruesome. But here's what shocked me, Lutzer said. There were perhaps 100 buffalo, if not more, all standing and staring and watching this go down. Now, I don't know if buffalo can think, he said, but if they could think, they might be saying to themselves, boy, am I glad that's not happening to me. Now imagine if the buffalo had decided to stop those lions, and together they ran thundering in the direction with their horns down, those lions would have scurried away immediately. The lions would have never had a buffalo for lunch if the buffalo stuck together and utilized the resources God gave them. There's a lesson for us here, he said. First of all, Satan separates somebody from the herd. He makes them mad at the church and Christians, or angry because of some other reason, and once they're away from the herd, he intensifies his attack. Isn't that true? Oh my gosh. However, instead of saying to ourselves, boy, am I glad that's not me, we must hang together as a congregation, close in on the devil, the slanderer, and go after the enemy of our souls. We can't do this by ourselves. We need each other. I need you people. And hopefully you need each other that's sitting by you, and we all need each other, and we can take care of each other. We are not in this alone. There's no Lone Ranger Christians. The Bible says in James 4, resist the devil and he will flee from you. All we need to do is stay together and visualize the spiritual resources God has given to us all, the blood of Christ, the Lamb, the word of our testimony. So you want to know how to win, be victorious over this? I told you I'd give you the answer. Read Colossians 2, 13 to 15 out loud. And I'm going to ask that we do that right now. And you, can everyone see that? Okay. And you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. And then you turn to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, and you read this out loud. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, let himself likewise partook of the same thing, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil. And then you say in this out loud with authority, in the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, by the power of his blood, I command that any evil spirits in this place leave and go to where Jesus sends you right now. And Satan cannot stand in our presence anymore. We have the victory, people. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And we are filled with God's Holy Spirit. And when we claim his Holy Spirit on our lives and our family and our wives and our kids and our businesses and our schools and our church, I know we do that every week. Probably more than once we claim the blood of Jesus Christ on this church. Because without it, we would no longer be a church. We would be a country club. We would start reading Oprah's magazine. Sorry, Oprah. No, I'm not. Out of mouth. Revelation 12:12. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them, but woe to you, O earth and sea, for the devil has come down to you in great wrath, because he knows that his time is short. When the devil is kicked out of heaven, he will be really mad, and he's going to take it out on those who dwell on the earth. This is towards the end of the 3.5 years of tribulation. Revelation 12:13, and when the dragon saw that he had been thrown down to the earth, he pursued the woman who had given birth to the male child. He's going to go after her with vengeance. Verse 14, but the woman was given two wings of the great eagle so that she might fly to the serpent into the wilderness, to the place where she is to be nourished for a time and times and half a time. A time is 1 year, times is 2 years, half a time is a half a year, so 1 and 2 is 3.5, 3.5 years. God will bear Israel away on eagle's wings, just like he did when he delivered her from the Egyptians in Exodus 19. He's going to take care of her. Satan is hell-bent on destroying her. You can see that today in this world, that every country over in the Middle East wants Israel gone. They want it gone from the face of the earth, and they will do everything in their power to do that. But God is not going to let that happen. Regardless of American policies or any other policies that countries might make against them, God is going to stand for Israel and they will prevail. So it's a good thing that we're on their side. It's a good thing that we're on God's side, because I don't want to be against God. I don't know about y'all. I don't want to do it. 15:16. The serpent poured water out like river from his mouth, after the woman to sweep her away with a flood. But the earth came to the help of the woman, and the earth opened up its mouth and swallowed the river that the dragon had poured from his mouth. God can even cause the earth to open up and swallow the water. Verse 17, then the dragon became furious with the woman and went off to make war with the rest of her offspring and of those who keep the commandments of God and hold to the testimony of Jesus, and he stood on the sand of the sea. These are the rest of the Jews that are scattered throughout the world who became believers in Jesus. They will experience a horrific amount of persecution during the last half of the tribulation. And yet they will hold on to the testimony of Jesus Christ and will be saved. If those people can do that through the worst tribulation man has ever known, we can overcome whatever is happening in our lives right now. It is not that bad. Yes, don't get me wrong. I understand that there's sickness and there's surgeries and there's double lung transplants and, and there's Parkinson's disease, and there's back disease, and there's all of that stuff that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong. But one day there will be no more of that. And until God decides to heal us right now, we have to just hold on. And I appreciate your faith and your stamina for doing that, you guys. But we can overcome the forces of evil in our own lives. All we have to do is believe that Jesus has already won the war and boldly declare our allegiance to him. That's what our persecuted brothers and sisters are doing all over this world right now. They are holding on to the truth. They're being persecuted. They're being killed for their faith in Jesus Christ. We can't lose. So what will it be for us today? Will we cower in fear before a defeated foe, or do we take a stand with Christ and watch that old devil run? I want to do something that we should have done and we do every now and then, but I want it to be part of our sermon every week. I want to do an altar call. I want to pray. I want to ask those that don't know Jesus Christ as their Savior to come forward. And if you don't feel comfortable coming forward, stay where you are. Just, you know in your heart of hearts that you need Jesus Christ. Because all of these things that we have talked about, that is a terrible picture. Can we put up something else? Man. I liked the picture when it happened. I mean, but, you know, to talk about giving your life over to Christ and all of that, that looks just like, we're defeated right now because he's looking at us like that. But I want to make sure that everyone that comes into this place knows Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And we give them an opportunity to do that. And seeing none, what we would like to do is also offer a time of prayer for people. I would like people that have something in their lives that they need to pray about, come forward. We'll have people up here that will help pray with you. We want this to be a praying church. This has started out as a praying church. I don't want it to end by praying. And I know that you can pray at home, you can pray in your car, you can pray wherever, but there's something about coming forward to the altar and praying and asking God to do something in your lives that's just powerful. That's more powerful than just being by yourself. So at this time, if you would come forward and you have some prayer request that needs to be made known, I ask you that you come forward and let's pray together. There's a lot that we need to pray for. Our country is in turmoil. Maybe your life is in turmoil too. I don't know what it is. But I pray that you would just come forward and just pray and get before the altar and just ask God to do great and mighty things in your life. Amen. Father, we praise you for this time. We praise you for the decisions that maybe that have already been made. We praise you for the power of prayer in our life. We ask that you would just continue to move in us, that you would just equip us and help us, Lord, to be the people that you've called. Help us to be and live victoriously over the devil, over his plans to hurt us and to harm us. God's plans are to help to prosper us and give us life. So, Lord, thank you for this time. Thank you for your word. And we ask that you would just pour out your blessings on each one. And we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And it also worked out, too, that we would do communion this Sunday. We'll have to give them a little time here. We don't want to rush prayer. But it was a great scene. Angels are rejoicing in heaven when they call on the name of the Lord. Oh, good background music. And as we go into communion, I want us to really just to think about what it means. It's not just a cup of juice and a little cracker. It's for us to remember what God did for us and the price that He paid for our salvation. Amen. Amen. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. That's the music that's playing right now. John, it's good to see you, my brother. He's recovered from surgery a couple of weeks ago. Major surgery. And he's doing good. Pray not only for John, pray for Cherokee as she tends to him and helps him get better. There's power in prayer, people. There's power in prayer. Whether we do it at home or whether we do it here, there's power. And at the same time that they're praying for John and Cherokee, let's pray for Kim and me. My brain just went dead, man. We need to pray for Mike and Karen and their family. They've been through a transition period in their lives, and she's hurting, but she's a trooper. I love her for her steadfastness and her faithfulness towards God, knowing that God chose not to heal her yet, and she's still doing that. And for others, Lord, that have some infirmity, we just ask that, well, we pray for Stephanie and her blood clot. We all have certain things that are going on in our lives, and we just need to be praying for them. And I pray that during this day sometime that you'll remember these folks. Remember the people that you're sitting next to. Well, duh, it's going to be hard to forget them. But pray for them, the people that are around you, and ask that God would just do great things. Amen. So now we'll get ready to do communion. Here comes Mark. And as the elements are being passed out, I ask that you would be in an attitude of prayer, that you receive this not flippantly, not, oh, we do this every time, but that it would be a time of reflection, that it would be a time of getting right with God and making sure that our hearts are pure and clean. We could do a whole sermon series on the Lord's Supper. But that night when Jesus was having supper with his disciples, it was the Last Supper. It was the Passover meal that he was sharing with them. And he took a loaf of bread and he broke it. He broke it. He broke his body. He said, "This bread is my body, which is broken for you." Do we get upstairs? Okay. The awful things that they did to Jesus that night. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think Jesus says, this bread is my body, which is broken for you for the remission of sins, for the forgiveness of sins. And then when we get to the wine, that's what covers our sins. That's what washes our sins away, is the blood of Jesus Christ. And this is symbolic of that. That night after supper, he took the bread and he broke it. He broke the bread, symbolizing his broken body. And he said, "Every time that you do this, remember me. Remember what I went through. Remember what I did on your behalf, that I broke my body for the forgiveness of sins for all of mankind." He said, "Take, eat, and remember me." And he poured wine in a goblet and blessed it. He said, this wine is the blood of the new covenant, which I shed for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, while the taste of grape juice is still on our tongues, may we be reminded that, Lord, it's all about you. It's all about your sacrifice. It's all about you willing to die for us on a cruel cross, to be beaten beyond recognition, to hang on a cross for hours, to go to hell for us, Lord, and redeem the captives and raise victorious, Lord, over the grave and the sin and death. And you are seated on the right hand of Father right now, Lord, and we praise you. We thank you for your wonderfulness. We thank you for your greatness. Lord, you are worthy of all our praise, and we give you all of it today. And we ask that all of this would be done in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. 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 Now the last song.
Yeah.